conditioning specialist and is the owner of Elite Chiropractic and Performance Center in Chesterfield Valley, a great location. He utilizes a unique blend of effective hands-on treatment and functional rehab and exercise to get his patients to move to better performance and ultimately better themselves. He is a Titleist Performance Institute, TPI, which we're all familiar with. He's level 2 certified and specializes in the assessment, treatment, and optimization of golfers. He believes that every patient slash client should have an individualized approach to strive and meet their goals, pretty similar to what Mike Adams is preaching. So we both are along the same lines. So without further delay, we will introduce from Elite Chiropractic and Performance, Dr. Chris Collier.
Speak the language when I work with actual fitness people. And describe kind of what I do or what a lot of chiropractors and UHPTs do, it's hard to describe, but we're all just about becoming the same profession.
I mean, would you agree?
Yeah. And so instead of saying, you know, I'm a DC, you're a PT, blah, 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 I think we're starting to evolve into even specialization. So looking at the way the body moves and how to optimize that. And, you know, the crux of what I'll talk about today is based around some TPI concepts. So is anybody in here TPI certified at all? We got a good amount. And I've kind of felt like there's been some pushback in more of the old school golf world on TPI. I don't know if it's just it's a mass marketed thing and so that's kind of frowned upon in general. But basically what TPI is just doing, it's just saying, look, you know, as you evaluate a swing, is there, whatever you want to call it, maybe early extension, is that due to them not understanding the swing mechanics? Or is there some kind of physical limitation there? And then on the third level, is it a weakness, a strength thing? So we have to start to triage that in order to be a sniper when it comes to treatment, or as a golf instructor, be a sniper to fix what you need to fix and stop kind of banging your head against the wall on a hip that's not going to improve because it can't. And understanding the concepts between that. So basically with TPI and a lot of the functional movement assessment type things, it's what we call the joint by joint approach. So the body, and this is a simplified version of what we find, but the body alternates in stable joints and mobile joints. So they're just certain joints that need less movement, more stability, others that need more mobility. So if you start at the foot's typically stable, ankle mobile, knee stable, hip mobile, and it works its way all the way up. Lumbar spine, as contrary to some people what they think, it's stable. We don't want a lot of flexion, lateral flexion, bending in a golf swing or in general. We want to get most of that movement through our hips and our thoracic spine. So the T-spine, even though you have a bulky rib cage and ribs attached to it and all the muscles that go with that, it needs motion. And I'm sure you guys have seen people that are rigid, that can't rotate in their thoracic spine, it's hard to get them square at impact. And so by understanding that approach, you can start to think about, that knee moves a lot during this swing. Whether that's normal for them is up to you guys, not me. But as I look at them, I might say, hey, whatever they're doing in their swing could be torquing that knee a little too much. They may not have a problem right now, they could in the future. Something to think about. So it's starting to look at the golf swing in a way of not how can we hit it better, but how can we hit it better for as long as we want to play the game of golf, you know, until we're done on the surface. So when it comes to the golf swing and the hips, we're talking mostly just the actual femoacetabular joint or the hip socket. The pelvis is also involved. But you have two hips, right? And so for a right-handed golfer, there's some guys that Tiger, yeah. So as a right-handed golfer, as you take your backswing, your right hip, your trail hip, is internally rotated. The lead hip or the left hip is externally rotated. As you finish and follow through, they reverse. Lead hip internal, right hip external. So as you look at this, so TPI does a ton of data collecting, a ton of stats, a lot of it on just about every pro golfer that you can ever think of. They've been to their facility, they've measured them, and we get averages. So the averages here are what they found with pro golfers. Now, thinking amateur golfers are going to be the same, obviously it's not necessarily going to be the case. However, you should expect similar rotation in just an everyday golfer as well. So what we find is that, let's say on the backswing, that right leg, 31 degrees internal rotation, left leg, 43 degrees external. And then on the downswing, the lead leg doesn't rotate as much, about 17 degrees on average, but that left leg, that lead leg, is still 43 degrees. So what does that tell you? You need more rotation in your lead hip. And Mike was talking about this yesterday, or last night, about, you know, if you're a front, a lead post guy, a rear post, so on and so forth. Where I'm coming from is there an actual physical or anatomical reason for that? can they physically not rotate that much into their lead hip, so therefore they hang back or they post up on the rear leg. And so once we know the concepts, and as you start to, what I'm gonna do later is just go over a quick little screen or two for you guys to do on the range if you need to, but it's starting to correlate the differences between with hip rotation and then whether or not they can get more or they can't get more. And who's the labral tear head back there? I might mention. Your hip's fine, but it's not.
Hip labral or shoulder?
I've been sitting today, so I'm, but I'm
So, you know, just basics there. So you don't have to get bogged down with the stats. In fact, I didn't know these until I did this PowerPoint. So it's not super important. You know, we do have baseline averages for basic people between external and internal rotation. But it's more about what's causing it. And so lots of things can contribute to a lack of hip rotation. Things for you guys to consider. You know, one of the common ones, and I would assume a lot of clients are in the realm of arthritic possibilities, I guess. So that top thing, degenerative joint disease, which I hate that term. I hate that we throw the word disease onto a term that just says wear and tear. As a human on this planet, we all get arthritis. It's normal in most cases. And yet, I still get patients coming in telling me their diagnosis of degenerative joint disease, which is like, Ms. Jones, you're 85. That's completely normal. If you didn't have that, I'd be very surprised. So, but it's something to know, especially if there's a bilateral difference. One hip's different than the other. You can't totally see here. This, which is probably the left hip, they don't have any markers on this x-ray there. Much more joint space in that left hip. This right one, practically bone on bone with a little deformation. The scary thing is, these people can walk around like that with minimal hip pain. So how are you gonna know? Again, if we're not assessing, we're gonna be guessing. But we gotta start to factor into these things. So this could start because of just a leg length discrepancy. It could have been a major injury when they were in college. It could be a major injury on the left side, which has caused them to favor the right hip over the years. The possibilities really are infinite. Labral tears, so again, a lot of people walk around with labral tears but have no idea they have one. In fact, they don't have pain in their hips, mostly because they don't ever produce the pinch. They're never in those positions. But it's still something to know that if there is some type of tear, that could restrict the range of motion. Now, my favorite ones, hip anteversion, retroversion. So this is just saying the angle of your hip socket can be oriented more towards the front or the back. And this is something that we can have at birth where it develops in the first year or two of life when we start to form our sockets or our joints and the length of our bones. So you can have where an anteverted hip just means that it's shifted in a way so that that individual is going to tend to have excessive internal rotation of their hip, more than the average. When they have that though, they're going to have reduced range of motion in the other plane. So this is something you can't physically change on people. If you're trying to crank, like let's say it's me and they're really tight in certain rotation, I'm trying to crank away with it on treatment, I'm going to make it worse. I'm probably going to hurt it. It's the same thing if you were to look at a baseball pitcher, especially like a higher up, maybe a professional pitcher. The shoulders do the same thing, where you'll take their throwing arm and you'll crank their arm all the way back to like 130 degrees of external rotation, and then they'll have literally nothing in internal rotation. But the total movement is about the same. So the worst thing to do is take a pitcher and start cranking their arm in. So it helps to know these things. Hip retroversion is the opposite. This is more of my problem, in that especially on my lead leg, I'm a left-handed golfer, I got no internal rotation, but I got a ton of external rotation. Okay, so when I squat, I tend to bring my hips out. It frees up my hip space. Things to consider maybe as you're working with clients. So there's ways for you to check that. Congenital traits, again, things that are started at birth, or early on in life, you can't change these things. The hip socket depth, that depends on the person, that depends on the ethnicity. For instance, Scandinavians are known to have very shallow hip sockets, which is why they're some of the best power lifters in the world. They can get in squat positions that most of us can't. It's an adaptive change that they've had in their lineage over time. On the flip side, any Irish people in here? Irish people are known to have very deep hip sockets. I'm not saying all of them, but in general, deep hip sockets, probably never going to see an Irish person win a powerlifting contest. They can't get to that point. So we got to understand what we're looking at here. And then, really, my favorite stuff, soft tissue capsule joint restriction. That is stuff that can be improved. That's things like joint manipulation, joint distraction, myofascial release, all these different ways to just improve the extensibility of the joint and the tissues around it. These are the things that really make me look really good, right? I can screen a golfer, we can check their rotation, and then I can put them on the table, treat them for less than 5 minutes, stand up, and it's a nightly difference. They're sold at that point. But you don't have to just get treated for this. Good mobility routines, just different things like that can reinforce that type of mobility there. So, common swing characteristics, as far as a reduced hip rotation, especially internal rotation. Now these are all, I'm sure a lot of you guys maybe use some of these terms, or maybe they're a little different. This is a lot of the TBI stuff. And what they had there in parentheses are, I think they pulled a bunch of amateur golfers and figured out what they commonly do. Now Mike Adams brought up a great point last night in that we've kind of made these things, we villainized them. Oh, early extension is bad, you know, a slide, a sway, all that stuff is bad. It's something we shouldn't have our golfers. However, what he was saying last night was that if that's their normal swing type and that's what they're natural in, you don't want to change it because you might mess them up, like we've seen with multiple golfers. I think Tiger was one of the big examples of use yesterday. Where I'm going to look at it a little differently and say, is there a reason why this person really extends? Not just maybe they played baseball their whole life and that's how they're used to it, but in my case, so I'm a right-handed thrower, but I'm a left-handed golfer, so it's backwards and everything, but I can't rotate really well as I come through. So if I were to totally follow through with my feet in a neutral position, I'm either going to hurt myself or it's way too tight, too much pressure. So I usually turn my foot out, I do different things like that, or, you know, not as much anymore, but I still have the problem. I throw my hips in because I can't rotate. So it's looking at it from an anatomical perspective. I'd say hanging back is a big one. If you can't post up on that lead leg, you're going to kind of post up on the rear leg. Some people, that's needed. Reverse spine angle. If you're noticing that, so for those that don't know, as you take your backswing, the body, the torso goes towards the target, and as you follow through, you the other way. That's the number one cause of lower back pain in the golf. Okay. The reason why, as you're bending here, you're taking these facet joints, the joints in your spine on the right, and as you follow through, you're smacking into them. And if you have a range session where it's 100 balls over and over, you're going to have some back problems. So right-handed golfers, typically right lower back pain. Typically what we find. So it's just kind of, you know, if you do notice these things, it's trying to get you to start thinking, okay, can we work around it? Or is there some type of anatomical or structural thing that could be leading to this? Now, how can you figure out some of this on your own? There's two tests that are quick and easy to do. The lower quarter rotation test is part of the TBI screen. The toe tap test is actually, it's a baseball screen, but it works the same. Those of you who know TBI, they do golf obviously, but they have the same thing for baseball, the same thing for tennis. They're just working in every single professional that works with that athlete and tying them all together with the same language and the same assessments. That way we're being consistent. So the lower quarter rotation test, I'm actually going to use. Is there somebody? Can I use you? So I noticed you're just sitting like that, and that tends to tell me a little bit about what the hips might be doing. But the lower quarter rotation test, we're looking for 60 degrees rotation bilaterally. The reason why it's more than the 40 or so is because now we're throwing pelvis into it as well as the tibia or the knee. The They all have to rotate together. Now, I have a little thing that TPI gave me where the angle here is about 60 degrees, so I use this to screen them out. I think typically a 7-iron, the angle through here, I think this is a 7, yeah, it's about the same. So you can lay a 7-iron down and then draw some correlations there. So what we do is we put this down here. So, okay. So you're sitting with your left leg up. So what I like to do here is kind of hold this here like this. That's going to give me the awareness, the first thing or whatever. This back leg, just keep it tapping on the ground right here. I want all your weight for the front leg. So the first thing you're going to do is kind of rotate to the right without moving that foot. So he is well short of 60 degrees. Can you guys see that? Now we're going to go the other way. So keep that foot down. So that's your backswing, that's your rear leg, your right foot.
Yep.
Okay. So as you open up here, he's about 60 degrees there. So all I know is standing in this test, he's got more external rotation in his right hip than in his left hip. So if you're a left-handed golfer, you're in trouble. Let's see you again. Same thing. So better, I'd say you're about 45, 40 degrees there. Better than the right hip. Just shy of 60. So it seems like you're about the same, almost not too different. You have the same injury. So the reason why I pick them out, those that sit with the leg crossed, especially if you're one of these that can hang out here, you're typically more retroverted. So I can literally take my hip all the way, but I suck in from pitch 10 feet. Some of the rehab I do is based on the Prague School of Rehab. The founder of that, I've been adult specific, it's called DMS. He basically kicked me out of the crowd based on how I was sitting. He's got broken English. And assessed me, used me as an example for exactly what I'm talking about today. That was just like 2 years ago. You've just begun. So that's the lower quarter rotation test. Pretty quick and easy. Okay, you're just checking to see rotation. So as I do it, so let me kind of show. So here, so this is my lean leg. Internal, not as good as in. External, probably even better. Okay. So things to consider. Okay. The toe tap test I like just because it specifically is looking at internal. So we use the toe tap test for a batter and a batter's box. Whether or not they should put their foot down in neutral, should they keep it out, can they bring it in? So it's just looking at that and then how they can propel and hit the ball. So what you're going to do with this is you'll have your, let's bring your left foot here, and you're going to take your right foot, you're going to bring it perpendicular, bring it to the middle here, and then from there, kind of then put your foot into the outer part of the club. So you're standing with this. So put your left foot. So I want the instep right where you have the in your feet. That's where your feet should be. There we go. How's your alignment? Your golf swing?
Pretty good, right?
I'm aiming there. No, you're not. You're right. So, okay. So you take the foot, you take the other foot, and that measures you across. And then I put the other foot to the side there, like that. And then what I'll do is I'll lay the club right in the middle. And so what I'm looking for here is keeping your heel down. Let's do the left foot. You're going to pick it up. You're going to rotate your foot in, trying to get to that club. There, about 2 hours later. Let's try the other one.
Go the same way?
Yeah, same thing. Better. Does that feel a little easier?
Yeah.
Okay. So, again, just you'll find there are people here that are anteverted. You guys are actually blessed to be better golfers because you can sit here and follow through and just keep rotating with no worry of what you're doing to the hip. So, people like Dustin Johnson have a little bit of that, and then they're actually a double whammy where I think they're hypermobile in all of their joints. They're flexible in every single test we can do, which is a gift for golfers. Now you put them on a football field, he's in trouble, right? And so, okay, thank you, I appreciate that. So, just some quick things. There's a lot that goes into this, so with a TBI screen, we're doing tests like that for the shoulder, the spine, the pelvis, the cervical spine. We're looking at how do they move, and the big thing is, can they do it, yes or no? Is it uncomfortable, is it painful, or does it look really difficult for them? The next thing you'll do is videotape the swing, do all the things you guys already do, get some swing characteristics down. So when you combine a history consisting of whether it's me doing it, you guys doing it, you need to ask what their injury tendencies are, what they've had in the past, what surgeries they've had. You'd be surprised how surgeries, whether it's an abdominal hernia repair or a meniscus in your knee, they all do play into how they move and function. So you want to get the history down, you want to check their mobility physically, and then you want to obviously look at their golf swing. And you're going to compare them all together, and it's like you're an investigator. You're trying to uncover some kind of, you know, dirty dirt on these people, but it's just their body's function. And so by doing that, you're really going to have a good understanding of maybe I shouldn't be teaching this specific swing type on this person because physically I don't think they're capable. And so let's optimize it based on what they've got. So a lot of what I do is this stuff. I'm a big nerd when it comes to this stuff. And you know, Mike Adams brought up a good point yesterday. Like, how many of you guys go and shadow other, you know, well-known golf instructors? And there's literally nobody raised their hand. And it kind of gets me thinking. I mean, I love shadowing. I would love to come and watch, you know, just about all you guys do what you do, so I can get a better understanding of how you guys approach the golfers and how can I fit in to help. I do. Not everybody at once, but I do treat golf professionals for free, okay? Just so that I can show you what we do. And if you guys aren't healthy, well, you're not doing any good healthy mindset. So I'm always open for that. So this is some of the contact info. You can reach me, email here. Here's the clinic clinic phone number, website. So I do a lot of educational content. I write a lot. I do a lot of videos. So I have a YouTube channel. You can follow me on all this stuff. And I just want to help people for free. I mean, it's a way of trying to get the